We're joined by the king of cool. Yeah, Jason Dunnington. He's coming up next with Aaron Brilbeck. This is Mitchell Talks, the News 9 Sessions.
I got a beef with you.
Yes.
You said the king of cool, and then you said Jason Dunnington, not me? All right. All right, man.
Well, you're the Zen master.
I see how that works.
We don't have this all works. It's great to have you. By the way, we love Jason Dunnington. He's a regular on Oklahoma City's number one rated political segment, but he's also the only one in town.
Right? It's because I live right here. I'm close.
And he's a state representative from Oklahoma City and a Democrat, and yes, the only one in town.
It's very cool. Hey, thanks for being with us.
Absolutely.
Morning. We've got a whole big weekend coming up. You guys have been sort of off. What, 2 days this week you're in session?
Yeah, I mean, it's spring break, so a lot of people are trying to be back home with grandkids or kids, or the school districts they represent are out, and they're all back in their districts. So I'm sure my kids wish that I was a little bit more cool, and we were gone somewhere too, but it just didn't work out this year.
Didn't pan out. Yeah. Hey, OMES dropped a bombshell on the legislature and said, hey, we need $16 million. We need it in 2 weeks, or else we're going to have to start furloughing people. What's going on?
Yeah, it really does seem like a bombshell. I mean, not many of us knew
seems
much
like deja vu
about it. Yeah, it does seem a lot like deja vu. I mean, it wasn't just last year at this point that the health department was saying, you know, $30 million or we're letting people go, and then they end up letting people go, and now what do we have? We have a big lawsuit of disgruntled employees, former state employees against the health department, and now here we're doing the same thing with a different department. I mean, deja vu is probably the best way to describe it. Still trying to figure out a lot of the details about what the ask is for and why so sudden.
But what I'm confused by is we've got a budget surplus, arguably. Y'all were able to raise taxes quite a bit to fund teacher increases, teacher pay increases, education increases. We've got more money than we've had in a long time. We're in a much better position financially than we have been in a very, very long time. How is it that nobody knew about this until last week?
Yeah, I don't disagree with anything that you've just said, and I think that that's the real question. How is it that we haven't known about this? When you kind of dig into some of what OMES is saying, there are remarks about how they'd been undercharging for IT services to other agencies because everyone was kind of tightening their belts and struggling a bit, and they had done that so long now that it had made up this big deficit and they needed to cover those costs. But again, that just seems like mismanagement altogether, and I'm not sure that it's in our best interest to just go write a big check to OMES right now and find ourselves in a very similar situation that we found ourselves in with the health department.
Let's take a step back and explain to people what OMES does, because they basically oversee everything. So if within my company here, within News9, if I need a new computer, my boss goes out and pays $500 for a new computer, slaps it on my desk. That's not the way that it works in state government. In state government, that $500 computer for DOC, for example, is going to be costing a lot more than $500. How does that work?
Yeah, it was kind of a new agency that was built to bring all of the agency's IT together under one roof. And the hope was is that they would save a lot of money there. But we've heard complaining and griping from other agencies for years now that they're being overcharged by OMES, that they're not getting the IT service that they need when they need it. There was a bill this year by the Veterans Administration that they wanted to pull their IT completely out of OMES. And a lot of that was for cost, and a lot of it was for efficiency. I think there are a lot of questions that need to be answered right now.
They also, when they were meeting with legislators, they said, yeah, we need $16 million right now or else we're going to be furloughing people, but we'll settle for $7
million. Yeah.
That's a bit of a jump, man.
It is. It's the one thing that I think that so oftentimes the everyday Oklahoma citizen who kind of casually pays attention to politics gets so frustrated with government in general and politics in general. It's these kinds of things. It's that everything's kind of clipping along and everything's supposedly fine, and then all of a sudden you have government agencies that are saying the sky's going to fall if you don't do X, and then everybody jumps on board and does X, and then we figure out later that, well, maybe it wasn't exactly the case. That's the real frustration, I think, for everyday Oklahoma citizens, because they want government to be efficient, do their job, and for the most part stay out of people's way.
Are you convinced that if this, if the legislature doesn't write this $16 million check, that the sky is going to fall?
I don't have enough facts right now to be convinced of that, no.
Senator Thompson said no.
Right. Flat up.
Yeah.
Excuse me. He just said, look, I don't feel inclined to do that. So that's sort of the end of the program, right?
And he's chair of appropriations on the Senate side. I mean, he would obviously have access to more information than I would have on that. But, yeah, I mean, there just aren't enough facts out here now, I think, for any of us to be confident or comfortable in signing off on that amount of money.
Well, last time you guys did that, what happened? It was the Department of Health. Mm-hmm. We need an immediate infusion of $30 million or else there's going to be mass layoffs. They wound up laying off 200 people. And then, surprise, we got the money hidden over here in an account someplace. We got it in a slush fund that we're hiding from the legislature.
And if you'll remember, it was OMES that was also overseeing that whole health department kind of debacle.
And the solution for that was to take the director of OMES and put him over at the health department. And we saw how well that worked out too.
Yeah.
So this is why people are so frustrated with state government.
It is a big reason, I think, why people are frustrated with state government. And it's just, in my opinion, it's unforced errors, if you will. I mean, we have some incredibly quality individuals that work at OMES, that work at the health department, that work in many of our state agencies. Salt of the earth people that have put their entire career into making our state better. And it's unfortunate that we have these kind of governmental fumbles that end up defining us more than the good things that we're doing.
Hey, can I read a headline that you might like? This is from Topeka Capital Journal this morning. Kansas House passes Medicaid expansion 6954. Last I checked, wasn't Kansas a fairly red state?
Yeah, Kansas
legislature.
Kansas legislature is predominantly Republican, just like ours is. This is a sign. There are 36 states now that have gone the Medicaid expansion route, and there are only 14 holdouts right now. And those 14 holdouts, it's at the expense of the health of their own citizens, and largely at the expense of the health of rural citizens, not as much urban. This was a great sign. I actually read the article last night, and they did some unique things in their Medicaid expansion. I mean, it's a Kansas expansion. It's not so much Medicaid. It'd be the same thing if we did it here. It doesn't need to be Medicaid expansion.
Call it. What's your idea on that?
We can call
it Larry.
Call
it
Larry.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, as long as we're not calling it Obamacare. Call it George. I don't care.
It is healthcare expansion in the state of Oklahoma. And, you know, they put in an amendment to the bill that said that if the federal government pulled the rug out, lowered the match from 90% down to something else, that the program would end. We could do something very similar like here. They put in another amendment that would have any new person that got onto the roles of healthcare would have to have some skin in the game, would have to put in some kind of monthly fee into it.
Not cost prohibitive.
Yeah.
We're talking $25-$30.
Yeah. I think Kansas's was 25, at least a minimum of $25 and not more than 100. I think that's reasonable.
Yeah.
I think Oklahomans, while we do want more access to health care, I think Oklahomans are hardworking, proud people that are willing to put some skin in the game.
We're talking some serious cash here. This isn't pennies. We're talking.
No, it'd be $1.4 billion influx of health care money in the state of Oklahoma. And again, it would shore up what we're losing in rural Oklahoma. People talk about the whole fairness. It's not fair that I have to pay for my health care and someone else may not get it. But what's really not fair is someone has to drive 150 miles because they're having a heart attack and don't have access to a hospital to get care, or drive 90 or 100 miles in order to have their first child because there's no OBGYNs that are in the area that they live in rural Oklahoma right now. That's inherently unfair, and we can fix that.
Well, there are other impacts, too. I mean, there are job impacts. There are property tax impacts. This has a ripple effect. We're not just talking about providing hospitals for low-income people. We're talking about increasing jobs, high-paying jobs.
Yeah.
We're talking about those people then moving to those communities, buying homes, buying property, paying taxes. There's a ripple effect.
Yeah, and in largely this healthcare is for the working poor. It's not for those that are refusing to work or sitting on their couch at home drawing some kind of government check. These are people that are largely working full-time jobs but aren't making enough money to pay for healthcare. And, you know, I believe that they deserve access to health care as well, and this is a way to do it. And it's our taxpayer dollars. So if we're not going to use it, then some other state's working poor is going to use our money.
$50 million is what Kansas will have to come up with. That's about two-thirds of what the health department lost would take care of that, right?
So they misplaced it.
They misplaced it, yes. Let me ask you this real quick, because we're about out of time. Cost of living increases. It's on the table. Is it going to happen for state retirees?
Yeah, the COLA is a big deal. Obviously, it's already passed almost unanimously out of the House. I think the big question now is, what does the Senate want to do? And they've put together kind of a working group now to, you know, research this a little bit more. I think it really now is boiling down to a political argument over, should we continue to put more money and savings into the retirement system and get them fully healthy, or is it okay to give a cost of living adjustment now? I'm in the camp that we need to give it now. It's been 11 years since we've given a cost of living adjustment to our retirees, and in that 11 years, everything has gotten more expensive. They need the adjustment now.
Okay, well, that's a wrap. Listen, we appreciate you coming by to this program we call Mitchell Talks, the News 9 Sessions with Aaron Brilbeck.
Cool guy.
The cool guy. And the cool and cool. And we appreciate you watching this. Follow me on Twitter, @MitchellTalks. See this again at news9.com/revoteCounts. We'll see you next week.